Hello, good evening. We are preparing for you another lesson on the course of Roma and MS quiz. In the very beginning of this video, I want to say that the next week, on the 15th of December, will be our last online session in which we will close this course, and it will be just like to meet and to reflect on this course is what it offered you, and also if you have some more questions. So therefore, I am going to make one session extra. What we will do today is I will speak about the visual arts of the Roma people. And also about the music, how Roma people make the music. And so let's move to the first part of this session, and it is visual arts. I want to present to you here like some introduction about the visual arts, which is important to say that there is this new phenomenon. There's like the turn and such a boom of Roma painters in 1990 in former Czechoslovakia and also in other post-socialist countries. And in the Czech Republic in 1997 was organized by the Museum of Roma Culture in Brno, first exhibition of which was called Alma Romana, which is like the word to the eyes of the Roma. And I also would like to say that the artists, the visual artists in Czechia and Slovakia are divided into two groups. But the first group are people who aren't who were amateur, like the painters without any academic background, and there were studies, and the another part or the group were Roma visual artists with academic background who studied it and who are professionals in their field. So let me present you the first group. It is, as I was mentioning, there was the exhibition, which was the first exhibition of Roma of Roma visual artist in Czechia. And also, it is also important to say, as I was saying, that these people aren't like professional painters. They used to have to work, and as you know, as we are speaking in the history in the first part, that Roma also lost jobs after the 1989, and these people were having painting or drawing like hobby, and you can see they were like their hobby. And also, they were doing it in their free time without any financial motivation. Who were them? For example, one of them was Lucian Olar, who was drawing with in pencil, or he also was making like the dots with the pen. On a piece of paper. Another, you can see here Jan Berki, Exodus from Slovakia, and he who was using like cheaper glues instead of the oil colors, and another is Rudolf Jurko, which is the most popular. He was considered in Czech Republic like the most popular and the best the painter without education, like the Persa in the in Czech Republic, and you can see his visual art is very specific because he is working on the glass board, and his work is really specific because he is working on the on the glass letter board, and he uses he was using a glue, and he was sticking like the grinded the colorful like the glass. And you see it's not it's not painted, but it is sticked like by glue the grinded glass. And another so that these are the most known Roma visual artists. When we are speaking also among the artists, it's necessary to mention the teacher Jan Sajko from Slovak Republic, who is a teacher in a village, or it is like it is the biggest Roma settlement in Eastern Slovakia in Jarovnice. Mr. Jan Sajko, he brought up several generations of Roma children who were painting, and their paintings and their art was exhibited either collectively or individually or in all countries all over the world. So Jan Sajko, you can see here, he's receiving award from the Roma Museum from the Museum of Roma Culture in Brno. He was also awarded not only in Czechia but also in Slovakia by Ministry of Education and of Culture. So here Mr. Jan Sajko is undoubtedly the person who is really understanding his students and is helping him. Now the another group I'm going to mention are already like the professional artists. We have opportunity to speak here about the first professional artists. They are already the Roma who are who or this group is containing two generations mainly, and they are Roma already who have the educations at universities or at artistic studios, and they reflect in their works on escalating moments of mutual coexistence between Roma and non-Roma, and also about the social burden that Roma are going through. Some of authors also deals with the topic of Romipen. Romipen, as you know, means Roma hood, and here is also very important to the question which is bringing Jana Horvátová, and I'm using her paper for this presentation. Jana Horvátová is director of Museum of Roma Culture in Brno, and she's opening there also interesting question because if Roma professional artists are dealing with Roma hood, with Romipen, in the society, this is raising the question whether is it still, whether is it still like the genuine art? Because here you can see like the conflict between between the like the self-perception of Roma artist persa and the society, like the taste of the society, which is deciding what is the art, and of course that it is also based on their canon and on their perception. So these are already elaborated the complexes, but we are not going to speak about this because the goal of this presentation is mainly to like to present you several Roma artists, and after we are able to find them and to study more deeply. Before I am going to present the first generation of professional artists in Czech and Slovakia, I want to recommend you also Zbirka Muzeumské kultury, which are known or visual arts of Romani artists, which is in both languages, in Czech and in English, and you can find there all painters from Czechia and Slovakia, and also their work. So one of them is Martin Kaleja Janov. You remember now I was speaking recently about professor or teacher Jan Sajko. So Martin Kaleja Janov is one of the pupils who studied artistic high school, and he devoted himself with painting, and now he's also working as a teaching assistant at elementary school. He works with Roma children. So this was one of them, and the other artist is, for example, Viera Petrášová. She's coming from Lovary, Romagu, and you can see she is painting on the ceramics, she is inspired by the folklore. Or another is here Alexander Boho, who is studied historian and also artist, and also here is also David Dozeman, who was a restaurator and also a painter. Here you can see this painting is on the wall outside of the building. It's like a facade of the building of the Museum of Roma Culture in Brno. Or another one is Vera Kotlárová. You can see her, how she's depicting a Roma woman looking into the world, into the society, having her desires or fears. Another is very popular, Ladislava Kažijová, who has received like several awards, and she's also engaging with activism and helping Roma youth in Roma locality, and she's running library of Roma literature, because she wants to support Roma youth and Roma people, like to know more about themselves. So this also Alisava Kažijová. Or he is also from Slovak Republic, Emilia Regová, who is also artist, and she was awarded by very the prestige award in Slovakia. She's dealing also with the topic of the alter ego. She's using hair, and you can see here how she's here in the traditional Roma costume, and she's here like the clothes normally. So you can see that these Roma painters are also solving representation or not representation. I mean rather like the perception, like the self-perception, like themselves as Roma. They are dealing with Roma identity. Also, there are among Romans aren't only painters and people who are making the performances, but also statue makers. So, for example, Božena Psikrilová. She made this statue this Satati is amazing, and it's also needed to mention that the Bozenap Sikilar that Bozenap Sikilova is a blind Roma woman, so she cannot see, and she made this the Satati. This Satati is exposed in the office of not in the office yeah in the office of a human rights defender, so you can find it in Brno there. And also it's important to mention the family of the Rigovci and Cherkezovci from Western Slovakia, who are the professional smith makers, and their work was used on the exhibition Expo in 1967. It was representing Czechoslovakia. Unfortunately, it wasn't mentioned that it was made by Roma family, but they are continuing this their craft, and they are passing it on the generation, and it's very popular. This family for this art. And now let me also very briefly to show you the European Roma visual artists who are the most popular. There are much more, but we have limited the time, and I'm sure that you will be able to find them more. But let me introduce you Chaya Stoika. We were mentioning her already in the literature, and she was also painting her rememberings, because she and her family, they were in the concentration camp in Auschwitz-Birkenau. She was from Austria. Or here is also, for example, Daniel Baker. Also Daniel Baker, who is coming from the English Roma group of Manichel or the Travelers. You can see he's dealing with the discrimination also. Or Damian Leba, also from the UK, also coming from the Traveler community. He was making like nice like these maps and showing that Roma people are also in Europe at home. Or Malorzata Notas Mirga from Poland. She's using like the textile, and she's picking it on the you can see. And also I want to mention the Gabi Jimenez from Spain, who has owned style of painting. Yes, and also from Hungary is Olah Mara. Olah is surname and Mara is name, and her main artistic name is Omara. For Omara, it's very typical that she's having like the blue, like the blue colored, like the painting, and she's dealing with her memories. So, for example, here you can see the picture when Mara was in the first like the guy, and she's writing here some message, which is here translated in English. But if she doesn't stand, she will end up like the other gypsy kids in institution. And also it's reflecting the situation of Roma children in Central Europe, how they were also put into the special schools or to the orphanage during the communism. And also this group of Sartatius made Serb at the Kazanju, which is important to mention, I like to show. I really appreciate this because he is trying to like to build. He is trying to build such like the common memory of European Roma. This is inspired by the like by the famous the photo of the representatives during the First World Roma Congress in the UK in 1971. So this was like the first part, the visual art, and now we are moving to the second one, with like the second topic is Roma music. Just to give you some like the background or context, you can know or you maybe didn't know that Roma music is a source of inspiration for several the composers, which are, for example, Ferenc Liszt, Brahms, Dvořák, Beethoven, Haydn, and the others. Do you know, for example, that Csárdás is derived from a word Csárda, which is in the Hungarian language pub. And in the 19th century, a folk song became popular among Hungarian nobility. And on this has influenced the Roma people, and especially Tsinkapana. Tsinkapana was like the first Roma violinist, the woman in Hungary and in Southern Slovakia. And she was playing in the coffee houses or the musicians, the musicians later were playing in the wine bars. I have to say also that the position of the Roma musicians was one of the most important because, as you know, Roma were enslaved, Roma were persecuted. They never had the power to represent themselves in education. And the musicians had the opportunity to be the closest and in very good representable the position. And also, if you know that. And also, another interesting thing I want to say that if you know that the Roma people in Russian Tsardom, in Russian Empire, were the served in the agriculture, and later they became like the musical serfs. So, but we will speak about it, we will see it. Here, I am providing you with such like a basic and the most important, you can see how the Roma music in Europe has divided, for example, or like the four, there are four regions in which Roma have influence even on the music of the non-Roma societies. It is in the Balkans, in Austria, Hungary, in former empire, and Russian Empire, Spain, and Saint-Domingue, the Czechs, which was in the Western Europe. So I think here I will play you several YouTube videos, so that we can see. So the first we can speak about the Balkans. There is exception in Serbia and Romania, because the Romania, as we know today, it wasn't at that time like this, because the Transylvania was part of Austria-Hungary, so there is more music like Csárdás, whereas on the south of Romania is like the vast music, because there was Ottoman Empire. The same like in Serbia, the southern Serbia was Ottoman under the Ottoman rule, whereas the Vojvodina in the north was part of Austria-Hungary. Like the most the popular interpreters are Mahalarai Banda, which is like the brass band from Romania, or Boban Marković Orchestra, who is from Macedonia, or Esmara Džepova. She was considered the queen of Roma music in the Balkans. And she was from Macedonia, and Shaban Bajramović, also was considered by the king of Roma music. He was from south, from the Serbia. It was like the Roma music of the Balkans, and you can also see from the analysis Austria-Hungary, and which is popular, for example, Robi Lakatos or Janoškovci from Slovakia. Like their most popular was Čardáš and Halgato. Halgato is like the sad moderato rubato song, and Čardáš is like the fast the song. And let me show you some example. So here you can see Robi Lakatos. Robi Lakatos is one of the most popular Roma musicians coming from Hungary. He's playing also jazz or classic music, and also Čardáš. Another, we are coming back to our presentation, and it's also interesting to mention the Russian Empire. Roma from the Soviet, like the Soviet Union, which have also similar folklore. And you can see here, I have prepared for you a video from the Roma theater, Roman, which was founded already in 1937. Here I'm going to share you like the video, you can see like the dance and the singing and the music of Russian Roma from Roma Theater Roman in Moscow, which was opened already in 1937. So this was music of Russian Roma. This was the group of Russian Roma, and now we are moving to Spain, to flamenco. Flamenco is also something which is really Roma thing, and the Roma in Spain are running a movement for reclaiming the flamenco. And let me show you also example. I'm going to show you the popular song "The Soy Gitano" by a Spanish Roma, the Camarón de la Isla. Como é que the camera on the light now. So this was Spanish Roma singer the Cameron de la Isla, who has recorded the several the CDs with with famous the guitarist the Paco de la Lucia. And the last group or the region in which Roma also changed the music is like the Sintomanus jazz, mostly of Sinti and Manus, which is in France, in the countries of Benelux, and in Germany. Let me show you Django Reinhardt, the icon of the Manus, the music, who played the guitar with only two fingers, which is unbelievable. And I don't have to say more, and you can just watch. So this is Django Reinhardt, and you can also, for example, watch like the, his family, who are continuing now, which are playing like the trio, which is called Rosenberg Trio, which are playing amazing music, and they are following the tradition of the Sintomanus music. So this was like very basic. A very basic overview of the regions, which whose music is impacted by Roma. I showed you just legendary names. Of course, there are also new generation who are playing, I'm sure that you will be able to find them. Let's approach more Central Europe and particularly Czechia. In Czechia, we know that the majority are Slovak Roma, who came from Eastern Slovak, and Lovari, which are called Olaški Romové, or in Hungarian, Olach Cigáňo, and how they call themselves. Here among Slovak Roma is popular Čardáš and Halgato, because Roma from Slovakia or the Czech Roma today are like the descendants of Roma coming from Slovakia to Second World War to the Czech lands. And popularly that was like cimbalom music, and after in the 60s the new generation were inspired by like the Beatles, Rolling Stones, and the others groups. So Roma are changing their music, and it's being born the such new style, which is popular only among Roma in Czech and Slovakia, which is called Rom Pop, which was one of the inventors of this Rom Pop also was the Vera Bila. I will play you also one song. And for Lovari Roma, there is also an interesting thing to mention that Slovak Roma, there were several families which had the music making like a traditional craft. So for them, the music had also function also how to survive as a work. Whereas before the Lova Roma, the music was only something which was only among the Roma themselves. It wasn't presented in front of the non-Roma people, because law is in Hungarian horse, so Lovar Roma were horse traders, and they were leading until 1959 nomadic way of the life, and the communists had they were forcibly settled by the communists, and their music was initially without any musical instrument. It was just making voices, like with clapping their hands, sa 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 sa, tamping with their like the foot, or snapping their fingers, or using the things as a musical instrument, as a jug, a can, or spoons. They are also dividing their song like Lokedila, which are sad, which are similar to Hagato, and Kelimaskedila, which are faster for dancing. And for Lovari music is now popular Domáco Mamuko from Slovakia, or Rozsa Nikolić Lakatos from Austria, or Parnogás from Hungary. And now I'm going to show you some examples. Here I am going to show you popular Roma band from Hungary, which is Parnogás, and you can see they are using also a cane, and I think that somebody of them also the spoons, and you can see also like the traditional Lovari dance. So this was Parnogras. Parnogras means in Romanes, the white horse. Another video I have prepared for you is from Slovakia, from Eastern Slovakia, from Bardejov. You can see here how it is similar to Hungarian one, and it is Eastern Slovak traditional, the folklore, including the dance. So this is from Eastern Slovakia. And another, as I was mentioning, the Rompo. Here is a very popular song, Paše Panjuri, by the Viera Bila, who was coming from the Czech Republic. And who was in the turn of the millennium, like the most popular singer coming from the Czech Republic in the world.
Jedem na to, no.
Raz, dva, tři, čtyři.
Pašu paňori, čaj, juri, romani, mela i geka má. Pašu paňori, čaj, juri, romani, mela i geka má. Joj, mamo, joj, mama, te mám paní. Mamo, te mám paní. Mamo, te mám paní. Joj, mamo, joj, mama, te mám paní. Mamo, mám paní, mámo, kde mám paní. Pašu paňori čaj, juri romani, mela i gekama. Pašu paňori čaj, juri romani.
So this was also shooted in one of the Roma settlement in Slovakia. It's already older video clip, and I was also mentioning Halgato, just to know what is Halgato. Halgato is a song which is like a sad and also. And this also, rubato, and these songs are today mostly played on funerals, and unfortunately, these songs are slowly getting lost. So it is important to keep them, because I consider it as a cultural heritage of Roma people. And here I'm showing you Dukadoilo. Dukadoilo means like a painful heart by Milan Godla, who was a singer from the Košice, where is the Roma theater, Romathan, in Slovakia, and you can hear it.
Tu mamo preke plaka, a make tu rovi bne.
Was Halgato. Milan Godla is singing about the son who is approaching his mother, who is dying at home, and he is promising her that he's going to collect 100 herbs to heal her and so that she doesn't has to pass away. And after his mom is dying, and he's saying that at the cemetery he's leaving his mom and also his half of his heart. So Halgato mostly were really sad songs, and the topic is about relationships to mom or to wife, or about the children. There is Roma where really the crying on their destiny, on their poverty, on their persecution by by a policeman in the past. You can find also such, and mostly this about the poverty of the children. And I want to show you also, as you remember, I was saying that the Halgato, like the Chardas, was popular with the cembalo music. But here you can see also how Vera Bila, again I'm using her with her group Kale, are playing all traditional Roma Chardas in the new way, in accompaniment of the guitars.
I'm
this was Czardas in the modern way, an accompanion of the guitars. And we are moving back to the presentation. So we could see this like the music of Roma in Czechia, but it is also applicable for Slovakia. And the Parnogras I was the playing to. And now let me provide you as well another perspective of Roma music. Here, for example, significant musician. That's Inka Pana, I already mentioned her, and also Django Reinhardt, we have the Kubík. Jožka Kubík was Moravian Roma, and let me also provide you with another perspective of the Roma musicians that you can see here that if you were playing or the topic is similar as I was mentioning when we are speaking about the Roma visual artists, about the perception, what is art, and if Roma artists really are. Here we can see also that this like the three protagonists who are really they like to change music, and they were also musicians, like performers. The four non-Roma people, you could see if they were working with the Roma traditional elements of music, and also if they were creating it for it could be likable or well hearing for majority society. After this they could have bigger popularity. So for example, Zinka Pana, I was speaking already about her, and Jožka Kubík is here. He was the first violinist player from Moravia. The first violinist player is called Primáš, and Jožka Kubík is very important to mention that during the Second World War, he and his family were deported to concentration camp, and he was returned because of some the cultural, the folklore association, who said that he needs to stay alive, because he was the person who changed the Moravian folklore. He was very innovative, and he brought the cimbalom. So cimbalom in Moravian folklore is just thanks to Jožka Kubík. And Jožka Kubík was really a respected musician and also a respected authority. So on the honor for him, Jožka Kubík is also, according to him, is a name of the minor, the planet between the Mars and Jupiter, and also Django Reinhardt, when the Nazi occupied the France, Django Reinhardt was on tour in the UK, and with his cousin remained in the UK, and he decided to return to the France. In the time when Roma were in the concentration camp, Django Reinhardt was allowed to perform, and he has a very popular song, Nuage. And Nuage is like the kind of the protest against the Nazi who were occupying France, and the Nazi soldiers were attending his concert, in which he was playing this the song. And just to sum it up, I want to say that not all Roma people are musicians. It's a stereotype, because you know, Roma people they carry out several different the crafts. The music has own function in the community. For example, in Black Roma groups, it has also function like like for fun, and also like to tell the story. If they have Hallgato, their Hallgato songs are much longer, and they have more strophes, and mostly they are conveying a longer story to the people. And also want to say that the playing music for Roma and non-Roma people is also different. For example, if you go to Hungary, there is very popular that there are restaurants with live Roma music where is played not real Roma music, but it is music according to which is accepted according to the taste of non-Roma people. So this is also like this. And here is also like a particularity of the position of Roma musician in the Roma community, that for example in Eastern Slovak Roma, like the musician, and not only in Eastern Slovak Roma but also in the other groups of Roma people, the musician had like the biggest position in the in frame of the Roma society, how to get into the non-Roma society. So, and they were mostly one of those people who were paid in cash, like the financially, because for example, before the Second World War, many Roma were paid in Eastern Slovakia in barters, you know, so they were receiving just some food. They weren't allowed, or they had an opportunity like to plant, like to have some storage of food and to be able to plant, but they were helping like the farmers, and the farmers were providing them with the food like daily. So this is also important to say. Here are the sources, and I thank you very much for your attention.